in week 5 of the 2020 Pro Chess League season on Chess.com. Fabiano Caruana took the white pieces against Alireza Firouzja in a battle that was critical for the Western Division. Now, while the team up north from the U.S. may have gone down swinging against Fabi's archbishops, it didn't stop the 16-year-old from Iran from yet again giving us a brilliant, head-turning, heart-stopping performance. And the game you're about to see, in my humble opinion, might actually be one of his best games to date. And I know that's saying something, given that it's rapid, given that it's online, but knowing the preparation and the stakes that these players are bringing to the table, I don't think it's that far-fetched. You're about to see a brilliant sacrifice that not only comes engine approved, I know I've analyzed it pretty deeply, but also maybe teaches us something about how to evaluate the positions before we dismiss such things as white's pawn structure is way too solid to ever think you have a breakthrough. Now that I've foreshadowed it enough, let's dive in, see what we can learn, and have some fun with another great performance by the young man from Iran. So, we have a Ruy Lopez, and I keep saying this every time I'm commentating on the Pro Chess League, that when Fabiano's playing, we're going to have a Ruy Lopez, and it just happens pretty much with either color. Now, after knight f6, Fabi chooses the anti-Berlin, known as 4d3. It should be noted that earlier that day, when Alireza was white against Le Quang Liem, he actually castled and invited a main line Berlin that ended in kind of a fancy forced draw. You should check out the video on demand replay or go find the game at chess.com. But we're not going for the main line Berlin. We're going for d3, a very flexible approach and a common one for Fabiano. Now, after bishop to c5, Fabi plays the voluntary exchange, I like to call it, with bishop takes c6. Voluntary in that you're not waiting for black to gain a tempo here. Now, why would you do that? Well, what you're saying after bishop to c5 is, while this is an active developing move for your bishop, you're also not doing anything to guard your most precious center pawn. So when I take c6 and then immediately play knight bd2, I have a very clear plan. I want to put pressure on the biggest target on the board. Note that you should never take on e5 with the bishop on c5 right away, because you should always be aware of these types of tactics that can occur in the Ruy Lopez. If you weren't aware of that pattern, hashtag you're welcome, and don't forget it. So you don't take right away, you bring more pieces in. And white's idea is very straightforward: to play knight c4, get castled, and make black play some retreating moves here. Retreat, normally black does. Things like bishop to e6 and then knight to d7, so the bishop doesn't get blocked as a main line. Things like castle and then rook to e8 is a main line. Even voluntary knight d7 is more common than the move Firouzja played. But he played bishop to d6 here and did so kind of quickly. Now, only 8 games occur in the database that I have anyway, but it doesn't mean that this is a dubious move from Firouzja. I actually think it might have been a little bit of home cooking, not in any sort of over-the-top, enterprising, brilliant idea. I'm not going to add drama where it's not there. But it does offer a little bit of flexibility, and as we see from Firouzja's approach, maybe it helped him get a little bit of a practical edge against Caruana. So the point is, after bishop d6, knight c4, and then backing up to d7, you're inviting the trade here, because it's almost never something that really helps white to undouble black's pawns. And you're saying that I'm not actually that worried about blocking my bishop in this variation, because I'm going to find new life eventually with the b6, a5, bishop a6 development. Now, again, you can check out my blog. I analyzed and posted a game to show you that Wesley So, the last time he had this position, he played bishop e6 instead of bishop to d6. So it has been played by many top grandmasters. But maybe this new approach from Firouzja and this development we start to see on the queen side by black, as you see here, will become a new approach to the position. Who knows? The first official novelty was actually Fabiano's move with the move b3 and bishop to b2. But I would say we're kind of already in original territory after bishop to d6, right? Sometimes you get the official novelty a few moves later when a top player surprises the other with a move that's in the database, but not by any of the world's elite, that being bishop d6, right? So b3 played, very principled from Fabi. Let's bring more pieces to hit the center. But I'm just sort of setting the tone with the fact that the players are reaching kind of a standard position here that happens in this anti-Berlin, but with some sort of uniqueness here in terms of the approach that Firouzja takes. The bishop being developed to the queen side, anticipating that maybe in the long run that will pay off. And I'm going to try not to say anything else to not spoil or provide any sort of more foreshadowing than I usually do. But it's an interesting decision, because the bishop is kind of chewing on granite, either looking at the rear of the horse here or looking at the pawn on d3 without a lot of breakthroughs. But obviously, we're going to see that the big picture, should that structure change, may actually prove the bishop to be very useful there. Now, after bishop to e6, sorry, bishop a6, the knight comes to e3 to start heading in for f5, right? Makes a lot of sense. Bishop to c5, queen e2, and now f6. These are kind of just natural developing moves by both sides. Obviously, the queen connects the rooks here, right? Let's have fully functional development. Black sort of follows suit by playing knight f8, queen to d7, and then rook a to d8. Now, this is probably our first critical moment of the game where Fabiano plays a move that the engines frown upon a little bit, but I would argue that the more aggressive move wasn't that good anyway. So, knight hg2 was played to play f4. The engines suggest you might be able to get away with f4 right away, but this is not a move anybody plays if they haven't prepared it. For one, after e takes f4, if you just take back with the pawn, you're losing a pawn in the center because of this sort of unique and kind of cool development of the bishop, right? So some tactics occurring that maybe you're not totally familiar with if you played this structure before, even for someone like Fabiano. If you take with the rook, well, then the knight comes to e6 with tempo and knight d4. And this also looks very, very good for black. It's amazing how quickly black's pieces go to just feeling like every single one of them is perfectly organized and right in the center, ready to strike. The fun line the computer gives is that after e takes, there's this move knight e to f5, which is sort of strange and actually inviting the fact that if you keep taking, white eventually gets some interesting attacking chances in this variation. So not something a human would do, but the computer does recommend black can play knight g6 instead of taking g3, and the position is probably still a little bit better for the second player. So I won't go too much more into that right now. But knight hg2 was played, and I think this makes a lot of sense. After the move knight e6, here comes f4, and it seems that white should be okay. The main point being that on knight d4, yes, you've got a knight in a good square, but I can just move my queen. Why? Because I really don't have anything to worry about on the queen side. The structure is incredibly solid, all held together by this very, very important base pawn in the structure, right? The base pawn is the pawn that kind of starts the chain, right? With that pawn falling, everything could fall, but there's no way for it to fall without a piece sacrifice, right? So it feels very, very normal for white to say, I trust in the strength of my structure. Let me now bring my pieces over here to the king's side. I've got the queen. I've got a couple knights that are going to help me. And I was analyzing this game live, in full disclosure, joke's on me. I thought Fabiano was a little better. I may have been suffering from a little bit of Fabi bias-itis, which they do have a pill for, I'm told these days. It stops you from being commonly biased toward the average 2800 player. But for all of us that have that disease, normally we assume that they're actually in a pretty good spot. And I thought that Caruana's position looked fine because, like everyone else, I thought, yeah, the queen side looks solid and here comes the king side attack. Maybe this knight isn't even doing that much. But Firouzja had other ideas in mind. He played queen f7 to get the queens off the board, but I still liked Caruana's position because after the trade and the take here, the opening of the position, here comes rook d2 and g4, tells me that everything for white is aligning. I still have a very, very solid structure. My pieces are coming together over here to the king side. F6 is weak, here comes g5. And the king is actually kind of a target as it is in the center. So I'm gonna give you a chance to pause the video and prove every single thing that I just said about this position wrong. You're welcome. Okay, assuming you're back, and I assume many of you have actually seen this game and you're just here for the jokes and whatever the educational element is I'm going to help us take away from this, and so you already know the move. But if you haven't and you actually found it, then you're amazing and you should go be a super GM. The move that Alireza plays here points out something, which is that, yes, white structure is totally solid. And if I don't do anything about it, then it actually feels that not only is white going to burn me over here on the F-file, but all of these really well-centralized pieces are kind of useless, right? You don't put all of your pieces in their most potentially active positions and then just surrender to the fact that your opponent has the files locked down. You should consider every possible way to make your pieces useful in the position where they stand before you abandon ship and choose a new plan. So that's like general calculation advice, right? Then if you actually take another step back and you look at the potential problems in white's camp, you start realizing that the one minor piece that black has that white doesn't is actually this bishop here. So again, currently it's locked out given the structural strength that white has, but if something about that could change, that bishop would not only maybe quickly become the most active piece on the board, unchallenged by a white bishop counterpart, but if you also take stock in white's potential weaknesses, every single pawn is on a light square besides this single pawn on h2. So suddenly you start to say, well, all of my pieces are actually in a pretty good spot. Maybe I should consider drastic means before I start relocating them. If I could just make my one bishop open and powerful. There's no white piece to directly challenge it. And finally, is it worth the gamble? Do I have long-term weaknesses to attack? Are there potential targets? And you start seeing that a lot of white's pawns are not only potential targets, but they can't even change the fact that they're stuck on light squares, right? They're sort of backward over here to the control that black has over the dark squares. All of these things combined with, if the nature of this game changed from kind of a borderline middle game, which is what it is right now, without even without the queens on the board, to an end game, all of a sudden you don't look at this king as being a weakness on f7. You look at him as being much more active than the black counterpart over here on, sorry, the white counterpart on h1. Suddenly all of this stuff makes me say, what do I got to do to open this position? Well, Alireza answered it. Knight takes c2. Here's Ali, double exclam, and he's bursting down the door. Yes, that was a Here's Johnny reference. I saw The Shining again recently, and please forgive me, but here's Ali. Knight takes c2. Boom, baby. The game is actually over. I'm going to let that sink in. I'm going to analyze this for you. There's some more exciting moments, but this is fascinating that knight takes c2 just knocked Fabiano Caruana on his heels, on his butt, and all the commentators with it. I had no idea this was coming. So knight takes c2 is played. Just to note, rook takes c2 doesn't help matters. After bishop takes d3, I'll just give one line. We can make trades, and in the end of variations like this, if you take with the king, rook d2 is good enough to win, and if you take with the knight, then rook d1 check is good enough to win. So you're not saving material by taking with the rook. Knight takes, taking the extra piece you've been given seems like a good idea. Rook takes d3, rook to d1. These are actually the best moves according to the engine. We get another pawn, and after bishop d4, Fabiano trying to trade pieces here to help the extra minor piece. Very good advice we would normally tell people. And so naturally, Alireza says, no, thank you. Backs up the bishop to d6, which not only keeps pieces on the board, great technique, but immediately prepares for the first pass pawn to start doing his thing. g5 is played. Here comes c5 and rook takes e4. And it was at this moment, I think we were already blown away by knight takes c2, and I believed in the potential of the sacrifice, kind of highlighting what this bishop might be capable of in the open board as it's really unchallenged, and that's kind of the main point of the sacrifice, along with all those white pawn weaknesses that are now off the board because black took them all. But this was the first moment where we started to realize, holy bejeezer snaps. Not only is this worth the gamble to sacrifice the piece, but I think black is just totally winning here, and indeed he is. After takes f6 and rook f2, we get another great move by Firouzja. Plays rook e2, which is such a good lesson for all of us to say, you don't start defending because you have pawns for the piece. And that's an important mindset because we get pawns for the piece and we think, I got to keep my pawns for the piece that I sacrificed. Otherwise, where's my compensation? But always in any kind of unbalance, forget the mathematical points. Choose activity and coordination. One pawn is not going to make the difference of whether you win or lose, because four or five pawns may still lose to a piece if those pawns don't get pushing, if you don't have activity. Whereas two or three pawns might beat a piece if they're active enough up the board, right? So you see, the point is, it's not the exact amount of pawns you have, it's the activity and coordination of your pieces that really matters. And rook e2 proves that. He says, you can have my pawn because I'm threatening bishop to b7, which not only hits g2, but might come to c6 and go gather that last weakness I haven't picked up yet. Rook e1 is played, borderline only move from Caruana. You have to stop bishop b7 from being lights out on g2. And after the trade and then bishop b7, as I said, we see this maneuver. Rook h3, just a very, very nice move first. I should acknowledge that because yet again, it's choosing activity and put your opponent on the defensive with rook f2 being forced in order to guard h2, and only then playing the move bishop c6. Bishop c6 was also winning right away, but this is rook h3 move. It's just very accurate, very nice. Rook e2, king d7. The next moves are Fabiano trying to desperately coordinate the knights to keep up with the two bishops and these crazy pawns that are about to get rolling. But spoiler alert, he fails. Here come the pawns. Knight e5 check and king b7. Again, another great example of technique. Don't trade if you don't have to. Even if you're probably winning here, don't do it. Keep the pieces on the board. Rook back to h6. Just bringing more coordination, preventing threats, and then the pawns. Everything at this point is just white trying to delay the inevitable with the pawns. Knight e4, b4, bishop b4, c3, bishop e3, and this is going to be my last moment of fun because I am going to say that during the live show, I commented that I think a faster, more accurate win, not just for fancy kicks and giggles, is indeed to sacrifice the rook, because the move bishop to d5 not only wins just enough material to stay alive, but it leads to a forcing line where you can't stop the queen right away. Guess what? I looked at it with the engine and I was right. 1 point for Dan, right? Can I get 1 point one time? Bishop takes, e4 check, and after the knight moves b3, it's impossible to stop the pawns. One crazy awesome line is a4 guards b3, and that's critical because the king moves to try to unpin the knight to help. But now you can take and play b2, and at the end of the variation, there's no rook to b3 winning the pawn. So anyway, awesome stuff. Bishop d5 might have been a more fun way to end it, but Alireza plays the very simple move, rook e6, just defend the rook. And after these trades, it's only a matter of time. A few more moves under time pressure was played, but the pawns did indeed get rolling. And once the brand new baby girl, probably named Brittany because she's coming to the b1 square, joined the party, Caruana decided it was time to throw in the towel. So hope you enjoyed this video. Hope you enjoyed this game. It was bleeping awesome. Firouzja giving us what we want as fans and as people. And Fabiano Caruana struggling a little bit in the Pro Chess League right now. He can be forgiven. He did just win Todd of Steel and Wykensee, the strongest classical OTB chess tournament to start the year. So we'll forgive you, Fabi, and good luck the rest of the year. I'll remind everybody that the full schedule this week, if you don't know what the Pro Chess League is going on. The Western Division on February 3rd already happened. This game was from the Canada-St. Louis Bishops match there, right there in the blue column. But the Eastern Division is Wednesday, February 5th. And then the Central Division is Thursday, February 6th. So check it out, and I shall see you around for commentary and on chess.com.